last video covered Angular modules, and in this video I'll be covering the best practices that I have encountered over my 3 or 4 years of experience in Angular. First off, let's start with naming conventions of our Angular modules. Naming typically is representative of its location in the project. So for example, if we have a project that's structured as such, we have a main that contains some module declared in index.js in a child directory of main that includes its own module. What we will call our module in our child module is main.child, assuming that the parent module is called main. What this does is it creates a hierarchy in your mind in order to find out which things have been declared as dependencies already in the parent, and it also kind of helps just picture where that module should be located at. The root module should be the name of the application. Sometimes it's useful to group applications by an entity. So what I mean by this is my application modules typically start with m3fauner, which is my GitHub account, or EW, my initials. So when you see these in examples, you'll see ew.main or m3fauner.blogpost. The reason I do this is because I am typically sharing those things with other people. So I want it to be attributed back to, you know, my GitHub account or me individually, so that they have somebody that they can contact. If you work for a company, for instance, that is large and has multiple UI developers, typically preceding the module name with that company name or a short representation of that company name is useful for sharing projects with each other and also potentially open sourcing them. Again, it kind of gives credit of the development back into the organization. This can get a little out of hand if it starts getting long, but really with module names, it doesn't really matter what they're named, so having a long name doesn't really hurt anything. So again, you'll see m3fauner dot something in most of mine, or EW, just because it's shorter. So moving on, we're going to talk about module file naming. So it depends on the build tools that you use. For non-Webpack / ES6 build processes, I suggest using the .module.js as a means of notating what module files there are. This is important for grabbing files by a naming definition. So for instance, if you're using grunt or gulp, you have to ensure that your modules are loaded first. So this means that you need some way of determining which files are modules and which can be executed after that module is declared. It's pretty rare to have to do that nowadays, but it's still important to note. With Webpack, I personally use index.js. The reason for this is you can drop off the file name if it matches your entry point. So for instance, if we have index.js defined in Webpack as our entry, I can have / directory / and just import that, and it will automatically import index.js. This means that my import statements are significantly smaller and they're not as repetitive, which really annoys me when you have to do / some component / some component dot module.js, for instance. Next, we're going to talk about utilizing ES6 modules. So here we have two files, app.js, which imports the child dependency and has the root portion of the Angular module. And then we have child in index.js, which defines the child module. Obviously, these aren't useful modules. They don't actually do anything, but this is just an example. So in the child, I export the default Angular module and then say .name at the end there. The reason .name is important is it takes the ew.child name and exposes it to any module that wants to import it. So you can see that my import statement in app.js is extremely simplistic. And on top of that, because I export the name, I don't actually have to use strings all over the place for the dependency modules. This is extremely important because if you want to refactor any of your module names, it happens automatically. At this point in ES6 modules, it takes away the importance of what your module name is to the point where it's almost useless. This leads to a much cleaner code base, in my opinion, and you're less likely to override modules by using the setter method twice. So a problem that existed in early days when I worked in Gulp was that new developers didn't realize that declaring an Angular module with angular.module, a string, and then an array actually overrides the module. This was the most common issue I encountered with new developers, and it was extremely annoying. With Webpack tools, it kind of eliminates the need for using getters, so this helps us avoid that issue where you use the setter notation twice. As I mentioned earlier, refactoring module names is basically free. Because we change a string in one file and it automatically gets exported to everybody else who actually cares about that that string gets updated, it's free to actually refactor it whenever you want. Lastly, we're going to talk about dependency declaration. It is extremely important to declare every dependency that your module uses. This has been one of the biggest pitfalls of development that I've seen in Angular. Modules are loaded in a non-intuitive way in Angular. What I mean by this is a module isn't necessarily required to be on, or sorry, dependency is not necessarily required to be on a module for it to work. What I mean by this is it can be declared as a dependency of some other module somewhere else in the application, and as long as that module has been initialized, all of the constructs such as the services and the factories and all of the like are available to the injector. This leads to a false sense of security, because if the user goes directly to a URL that is in a different module and that module has not declared all of its dependencies correctly, it could potentially lead to provider not found errors, all because they went through a different approach in the application. So to alleviate this, if you declare all your dependencies that your module actually depends on in the module definition, you can get away from this. Well, that was it for my Angular modules best practices. I hope it was helpful. Feel free to leave any comments about the best practices that you've found, and always feel free to reach out and contact me. Thanks.